So economics is mostly theory. So we discussed first three readings of economics in last class, and which was about demand, that what is demand, how do consumers drive demand. Then we discussed supply. Then we discussed aggregate demand and aggregate supply. We discussed market structures like monopoly, oligopoly, and all those, and perfect competition or monopolistic competition and all those. So that was an introduction, and still we so this whole section or this whole subject would actually gives you an introduction to economics. It does not get into complex calculations, estimations or theories. It is mostly an introduction to economic concepts. So now next topic is understanding business cycles. So what is a business cycle? A business cycle is a series of ups and downs. So economic concepts say that economies move in, or the economic theories tells us that economies move in the form of business cycles, in the form of a cycle in which there are ups and there are downs. These ups, or the way towards up is known as, or way towards peak is known as expansion, and the way towards fall is known as, towards bottom is known as contraction. So there are tops and bottoms, there are peaks and bottoms, there are peaks and troughs, and there are expansions and contractions. So any economy moves in a cycle of contractions and expansion, and this continues. This is known as business cycle. Now, as you move into expansion, economic factors start changing. So, for example, inflation rate will start changing, economic growth will start changing, consumer spending will start changing. And as you move into contraction, economic factors will start changing. For example, unemployment will change, inflation will change, consumer spending will change. Contraction is a slowdown. So therefore, in contraction, generally you will see unemployment increasing. So your unemployment will be going up. Why? Because companies will be downsizing the operations. Your consumer spending will be going down. Why? Because consumers will be spending less. And overall, your economy will get into a slowdown. Overall, economy's growth will start to fall, or the growth rate will start to fall. When any economy faces two consecutive quarters of negative growth, that is known as a recession. So if any economy sees two consecutive quarters of negative growth, that means its GDP actually falls in two consecutive quarters, that is known as a recession. So remember, recession is when an economy's GDP falls in two consecutive quarters. Similarly, when it starts expanding, when its GDP starts going up, then when it rebounds, we call it recovery. Within recovery, there can be early expansion stage, there can be later expansion stage, and eventually it reaches out peak, which is maturity, and after that it falls again. So this is how economy will continue to move. What you need to know as an analyst is that what happens when you enter a contraction, how will these factors change? What happens when you enter an expansion? How will these factors change? One thing to know, that these changes. And second is that you should know that what causes this change, or you should know what are the indicators for this change. That how do you know that you are in a contraction, or how do you know you are in an expansion, or how do you know you are moving towards expansion? So two key things to note are, or to know in this reading, or that you are being told in this reading, are that what happens when there is a contraction and expansion, one thing. And second, what indicates the contraction and expansion? That is indicators. So how does economic variables change? And what are the indicators for contraction or expansion? Any problem up till here so far? So this is how it moves. And if I look at the trend of this business cycle, this particular example trend, it is up trending. That means overall economy is going up, but it wouldn't continue to go up. It will go up, but it will go up in the form of a cycle. That within this uptrend, there will be peaks and there will be trough. GDP will increase, but then sometimes it will increase, sometimes it will decrease, sometimes growth will be higher, sometimes growth will be lower, and this is how it will move. So in different stages, activity or macroeconomic variables or economic activity will change or will be different. So for example, economic activity, which is denoted by actually your GDP or production or spending, it starts increasing in early expansion. It reaches maturity in it starts moving towards maturity in later expansion and reach maturity in P, and then it starts to fall. This is how economic activity will change. Employment. So when you are in a contraction, companies, when an economy enters into a contraction, companies start downsizing their workforce. So they start laying off the workers. When they lay off the workers, unemployment increases. Then when expansion starts, they start hiring workers again because they need more resources to produce more or to meet the demand. So unemployment starts to decrease. So in expansion, unemployment will decrease. But in this will be a lagged impact. Why? Because it takes some time for companies to decide to hire or to decide to lay off. So first they would actually identify the expansion, and then they would take a decision, and then they would start hiring. So there is a lagged impact. So it does not mean that as soon as you enter into a recession, your unemployment rate will decrease. It does not mean that as soon as you enter into an expansion, your unemployment rate will significantly decrease or unemployment will end. It just means that it will start slowing down. So if companies were laying off workers, those layoffs will start slowing down. And then eventually they will start hiring. Yes.
Can we say that the change in the slope of that curve is inversely proportional
Change in slope will be inversely proportional to unemployment rate. So here slope is low, unemployment, yes. It will be. So when slope is low, unemployment rate will be higher. And so not necessarily, because if you look at here in this point, unemployment will be lower. Here unemployment will be higher, but slope, only the direction is different, plus minus, but slope is approximately the same, so not necessarily. Okay, so employment, that's how employment will change. Consumer spending, very obvious. If you are into expansion, consumer spending will increase. Here it will reach its peak and then it will start falling, and if you are in contraction, consumer spending will decrease. Inflation. So when you are into a contraction, inflation starts to decelerate. Why? Because if demand is lower, if consumers are spending less, demand is lower, then obviously your inflation will decrease. Why? Because inflation is directly related to demand. Higher demand, higher prices, lower demand, lower prices. So here inflation starts to decelerate. Here inflation decelerates. Then as you enter early expansion, so spending has just started to increase. So here inflation decel here the decrease in inflation decrease in inflation will moderate or slow down, but still inflation will be decreasing. Why? Because this is just the start. Here the change has just started to happen. But later on, when you enter the late expansion, inflation will pick up or increase, and as you reach peak, inflation will be at its highest or will accelerate. So that's how inflation will change. Decreasing in contraction, then slowly picking up, and then at peak it will be very high. When you enter contraction, it will be very high. At this point of time, inflation will be very high. Eventually, when demand falls, then inflation will actually fall. So this is how these factors will change. A key takeaway or key point to remember, in addition to these, what we discussed, another key point to remember is that unemployment rate is a lagging indicator. It will lag the business cycle because it is a difficult decision to hire and it is a difficult decision to fire. So that's why it will lag the economic cycle. Moving on, which of the following rules is most commonly used to determine whether recession starts? So simply, as we discussed earlier, when any economy's GDP falls for two consecutive quarters, it is said to be in recession. So real GDP has two consecutive quarters of negative growth. This is called recession in economics. Moving on, resources used, that how are different resources used through business cycles? So this is something that we discussed in last class, in which we discussed that an economic downturn can put an economy into a vicious cycle where it continues to fall. Why or how? So if economy slows down, aggregate demand falls. So your aggregate demand curve shifts left, it falls, so you move from here to here. एग्रीगेट डिमांड फॉल्स एंड व्हेन एग्रीगेट डिमांड फॉल्स कंपनीज हैव प्रोड्यूस्ड ऑलरेडी सो देयर इन्वेंट्रीज राइज. When their inventories rise, they cut down the production because they know demand is decreasing, so they cut down the production. When they cut down the production, labor hours decrease. Labor in itself is the consumer as well. So when labor hours around the economy decreases or income levels decreases, that causes the demand to fall even further. So demand falls. And this continues.
Their income decreases.
Yes, so their income decreases. And so demand, or they might be there, maybe they are fired and so they cannot afford it, so demand falls. So you an economy can enter into a cycle of continuous decline. So that's why slowdown can lead to a crisis situation. Until and unless supply changes, or until and unless government intervenes, or any other factors causes the either demand to increase or causes supply to be adjusted with demand at a new level. And this is so. If this is caused by a policy, let's say if an economy or if a government or if a country has taken a policy to decrease the aggregate demand, that is to reduce government spending or to increase taxes or whatever. So if the decrease in aggregate demand is due to policy, then that is known as this recession, which it will result to or it will lead to is known as policy triggered recession. That your policies have led to fall in aggregate demand. So you try to control aggregate demand or just to reduce it for a short term, but eventually that led to a crisis situation or a recession. And also again from previous class, last class, that is this gap is known as recessionary gap. For example, if you are operating here and long run equilibrium point is this one. So this is your long run equilibrium output, but currently your output is lower. So this gap is known as recessionary gap. That is, you are producing significantly below your optimal level or your potential level. You can produce this much with the resources, but you are producing a lower amount. This is a recessionary gap. So this is how resources use will change through business cycle. In contraction, companies will employ lesser resources. In expansion, companies will employ more resources. A second factor is that what are the indicators? How do we analyze the direction of the economy, or how do we find out whether economy will go up or go down? So there are many factors which will come in later. But some of the key factors are capital spending, inventory fluctuation, and consumer behavior. Why capital spending? So capital spending means capex by the companies. If a company is making investments or is increasing capex, it means it will be producing more in future, which means it is expecting a higher demand in future. So this is an indicator of an expansion in future or an increase in growth in future. On the other hand, if companies are cutting down their capex budgets, that means they now expect a lower demand, and so that is an indicator of slowdown. So capex is a very important indicator. When you see companies increasing capex budgets, that is a positive sign. When you see companies cutting down their capex budget, that is a negative sign for economy. Then inventory fluctuation. This changes very quickly with the change in economic activity. So for example, a company produced 100 units because it thought it will sell 100 units, but it ended up selling 70 units. So that means its inventory will increase by 30 units. So as soon as an economy enters into a slowdown, inventory levels immediately increase. And if you look at the inventory to sale ratio, inventory to sales ratio, it will immediately or quickly go up. Why? Because your inventory has increased, sales have decreased. So it will quickly increase. Then later on, so that means if there is a sudden increase in inventory to sales ratio, that hints a slowdown. Then later on, company will cut down its production and will cut down its inventory because now it knows that there is lesser demand. So as it cut down inventory, then this ratio will fall. But at the time of the change, when the change is happening, this ratio will quickly or suddenly increase. So if there is a sudden increase, there is a sudden increase in inventory to sales ratio. That means there is a slowdown in the making, or the economy is slowed down. So you know. Then consumer behavior. Consumer behavior is very important with respect to especially US. Why? Because two-thirds of the US economy is based on consumer sector or retail sector. So if consumer sentiment is improving, there are consumer sentiment indexes and others through which you can track it. If consumer sentiment is increasing, that means consumer will be spending more. If it is spends more, then if consumer spends more, then economy will recover or economy will pace up. If consumer sentiment is decreasing or is falling or is deteriorating, that means that you can expect a slowdown. Moving on to some examples, related examples. Housing is more sensitive than other sectors of the economy. So when we say housing, so when we are looking at the questions, remember that you are looking at it in the context of Western world or in the context of US. So when we say housing, generally in Western world or in especially in US, houses are purchased on mortgages. So generally homes are purchased on mortgages. So when you purchase it on mortgage, you pay some interest on it. That is a kind of loan. So that means housing demand significantly depends on interest rate. So housing is more sensitive than other sectors of the economy to interest rates, correct? Because if interest rate goes up, demand will go down. Permanent income, government spending. So A is the best answer. Apart from questions of affordability, home buying also reflects the rate of family formation, correct? So if you can afford a home, you will buy it. So affordability is a factor in home demand. Secondly, the rate of family formation. If rate of family formation is higher, if population growth is higher, if new families are being made, if the number of marriages is increasing, then the demand for home or house will increase. Speculation on housing prices, correct? So if people expect, or the hedge funds or investors expect, or private equity funds expect house prices to go up, they will invest into it. If they expect them to go down, they will pull out their investments from the real estate. So both are correct. Both the rate of family formation and C is the best answer, that both A and B are correct. Yes, A is correct, B is also correct. So C is both the rate of family formation and speculation on housing. So best among these is C, because A and B both are factors. So C is basically A plus B. So both are correct. So if you just read A and select it, your answer will be wrong. So read through all the options and then select the best answer. Imports generally respond to. So when we talk about import, it is the goods which are coming in into our country, and generally they are luxury goods. When do demand for imports increase? Demand for imports increase when living standards in an economy increases. And when does living standards increase? Living standards increase with increase in GDP growth or GDP per capita. So that means if GDP growth is increasing, generally import demand for imports will increase. So imports generally respond to level of export, domestic industrial policy, pace of domestic GDP growth. If domestic GDP growth is increasing, then consumer will prefer imports over locally produced goods, and so demand for imports will increase. Exports generally respond to. So where is demand coming from for exports? So demand is coming from rest of the world or outside the economy. You are exporting goods to rest of the world, so demand is coming on from rest of the world. So your exports demand will increase if GDP growth in rest of the world increases. So it is just opposite of import. So pace of global growth. So although very simple questions, but you need to practice these questions to be able to answer them. Otherwise, they can confuse you. Okay, so that was about business cycle. We discussed that economy moves in a cycle. There are peaks, there are troughs, there are expansion, there are contraction. We discussed how different factors change through, or economic activity or inflation changes through contraction and expansion. And we discussed that what are the key indicators of contraction and expansion. Now, moving on to next part. Next part is some economic theories. These economic theories, I think that you should know the name and you should know the description of that theory, that what is that theory actually about. So starting with neoclassical theory, neoclassical theory says that demand and supply will automatically reach the equilibrium. It says that there is an invisible hand which causes them to reach equilibrium. Why? Because they say that if demand increases, price will increase. If price increases, companies will increase supply, and so a new equilibrium will be formed. If demand decreases, price will decrease, and so supply will decrease, and the new equilibrium will be formed. If price decreases significantly, then again demand will rebound or increase, and supply will increase. So it says that there is an invisible hand, or there is a free market, and in a free market, automatically equilibrium will be reached. This is neoclassical. Austrian school also have the same view. It also says that equilibrium will be reached by the free market or by the economy. But it adds another point. It says that government intervention should not be there. It says that if government intervenes, then market will enter into fluctuation. So it says if government intervenes, comes up with policies to change demand, to change supply, then economy will enter into fluctuations and will enter into cycles of ups and downs. So Austrian school says that what causes business cycle is misguided government intervention. So key point to remember is Austrian school is also against government intervention. Then come, sorry, neoclassical is also against government intervention, but it does not talk about government intervention specifically. It talks about only the invisible hand. It says that automatically everything will reach, a market will reach equilibrium. Then moving on, next is Keynesian. Keynesian said that government intervention is necessary.